So, good evening from my side. When Julia Hindering asked me to come here to participate to the conference, I remember that when I was the first time here, it was very long ago, it was in 1991, and it was, I remember now coming to this room, I really can remember, and it was a conference and it was called Die Städte sind weiblich und, den Sie und nur den Siegern hold, cities are female and just glorify the winners, only glorify the winners or appreciate the winners. And it was organized by the women's office in Frankfurt. And it was really, at that time, the women's office in Vienna didn't exist, but we were already preparing the exhibition. And I was really impressed because the keynote speak was done by Kerstin Dörrhofer, and she's a feminist theorist, a lot of feminist planning theory. And I was really there very admiring her, and so I thought it's really, I really feel honored that I have the chance today to show you a bit about what we have tried to develop in Vienna, inspired by her work. Julia Hindering already mentioned it really started with this exhibition and maybe also a bit the history behind, because I was a young planner working in the administration, and I was organized and I get to know, come in contact because I was doing district planning with a social democratic woman, female politician. And because she was there as a politician and I was responsible for the 5th district. And then she invited me to it was a open for every woman in Vienna. It was a weekend workshop about, and they asked about women's policy and they asked me to make the workshop for planning. And then I had all this feminist or planning theory in my head, but then I decided maybe it would be interesting if you just tell us how we live in the city, how we move in the city, how the neighborhood, how we are feeling for our neighborhood. And then I had the idea, but maybe the single working mother will not come, or the Turkish housewife, and so it was. There were a lot of architecture students, sociologists, but also old social democratic women working in the Social Democratic Party. But it was really, it was so inspiring for us that we decided to go on. After this weekend, and there was also women telling that in the 50s there was a big exhibition. It was called "The Frau und ihre Wohnung," the women and her apartment, and it was in the 50s to show the new furniture and the possibilities. And as a pupil, she was there, and she was so impressed. And then we said, now it's time not to make an exhibition, maybe the women and her apartment, this traditional sphere always connected with women, but the women and her city. And this was the idea behind this exhibition. And at that time, I think it was really something new, and that's one of my hypotheses, that I think female architects very often are the headrunners for new topics. Because nowadays, everybody speaks about public space. At that time, it was not a topic at all. Nobody spoke about pedestrian issues. So the traffic planners were really middle-class, white, male car drivers. And it was really the perspective. The biking issues just became a topic of barrier freeness, but nobody at all spoke about pedestrians. And so it was really quite a success. So the exhibition, there were 4,000 visitors, Swiss television, evening news were coming because it was something new and there was a lot of interest. And so also the politician realized it's something, they could go for it, so they get positive resonance from the public. And therefore, I was then asked to become the head of the women's department, because this was also something new in the city as a technician. And then there was, you already mentioned, the coordination office, and then we were, as the gender experts, we were as a small unit, so three female planners working together. Looking back, it was really a bit of feminist utopia working together for 11 years. And then we are mainstreamed now, the gender experts, and working now in other structures. But this is also quite interesting to have really now this insight in how the mainstream in urban development functions. And I think the aim is really, the goal to reach a fair shared city is really to support gender-sensitive decision-making and so really the systematically standing in different shoes. I have participated also during my professional life in quite a lot of juries or in the debates, so very often there is also making these connections to find argues which project is better. But I think the important thing for gender is really this systematically discussing it for different target groups. And it really becomes important when you have the conflict of targets. And I think planning is all the time you have to handle the conflict of targets, and then it's important. Or with a lack of money, which I think all cities have the same situation, so this shortage of financial restructuring, then it really becomes important. Vienna is one of the fastest growing cities in Middle Europe. And just to give you a bit the framework, so it's the capital of Austria, it has 1.8 million inhabitants, and the district level, they have the responsibility for public space, for the financial resources, and this is quite important. It's quite a green city, but it's a lack of open space in the central district. So we have this green belt in the outskirts, but it's really very dense. In the historical city, we have a quite extensive public transport system, and what I think is really something specific, 60% of people live in subsidized and social housing, and I think the city of Vienna is the biggest housing owner of the world with 200,020 apartments in social housing, which really helps dealing with social issues. But we have this urban growth, and we have, so there is a challenge, growing challenges with increasing public resources. This is a bit so what we tried to develop. We started with housing and then tried to reach the different topics, and I will tell you a bit. So it really started with gender-sensitive housing. So there have been some specific projects. I just want to present you the first one. It's about it only functions in German, this Frauenwerkstatt, because it's a bit the tool. Werkstatt means also tool shed, where you do the construction work. So this was the idea behind. And it was at that time, it was in the early 90s, and Vienna was growing, and there was the political goal to build and construct 10,000 apartments every year. So there was really the need of zoning plans and urban design for green areas, and so there were a lot, it's my pidgin English translation, of invited competitions. They were not open, but offices were invited, up to 6 to 8 architects. And although there were two female university teachers for urban design, Elsa Prohaska and Franziska Ullmann, they were not invited at that period. So they were just known as, was sind Innenarchitekten? interior architect, so they were famous for that or for design of exhibitions, and although they were teaching, they have not been invited to participate. There were only men designing the patterns of the new areas. And so with all the feminist planning theory in the head, the idea was really to say now, and we know also from Germany, this IBA competitions, where there were only architects, female architects, or IBA Berlin, the projects. So the idea was, and I proposed to the politicians, just to use it and to have an invited competition for a new neighborhood done by female architects. And the male city councillor for planning said, but this sounds a bit strange, and this, and then I said, I make you a proposal, we will participate to the same percentage, we will involve male architects, then the other way around, and then you're again at zero. As was it done now, if you just turn it around, and then he was convinced, and then we started for that, and we invited 8 architects. And for Franziska Ullmann was winning for the urban design, and 4 of them constructed design work. And as far as I know, I think it's still the biggest neighborhood designed by women in Europe. It's about 1,000 people are living there, and it's about 360 apartments. And one important topic was just to design a social space. So this was also rather important. So the idea was, for example, for anonymous. Not to be anonymous, and it really depends how many apartments are organized around the staircase. The sociologists tell it's about the greeting borders, when it keeps how many apartments you really. That you know that you know your neighbors and that you will still greet each other. And so it was really that there are quite a lot of staircases. There is a central, the pathway is organized centrally. Also the idea of, for safety reasons, that Franziska Ullmann changed the situation of the living room and the kitchen on every floor. So the idea was that you always see light windows when we are coming back, which gives a more friendly impression, and also this idea of Jane Jacobs, these rooms with social eyes. And also the variety of open space, so you have going back and the design, you see you really have these garden yards, and you have this central, this is a car-free settlement. And we had, at that time, there was also an exhibition, 90 Days of Architecture in Vienna, and there was a long night of urban design. And the idea was to debate 10 different projects, and the Frauenwerkstatt was also one project. And then there were 3 male architects discussing it, the projects, of course. And one of them said, oh, this is so conventional. This is really, you have a central place and you have garden yards and this is so banal. And we said, and this is so weak, the design. And I said, and this is why we as a jury just decided and voted for this project, because it's using its old European typologies, which we know that function, and which make a differentiation in the neighborhood, which makes a difference. And we said that this is the strength of the project. And maybe also to make the connections to the exhibition you have, because we were very proud that Margarete Schütte-Lihotzky, which is on the poster for the exhibition, she was the the head of honor of the jury. At that time, she was already rather old, but she really stayed there the whole day, and her eyes were rather weak, but she really tried. She was so interested, and we were all so impressed, and we were really very proud to have her in this connection with this project. And what also may be that there was, because it was quite clear that they made a mistake, and so it was that the neighbors were very important for the project. They couldn't have stopped it, but they could have delayed it for 2 years because they had to buy some lands because there was an error in the Geometer plan. So it was a bit a difficult situation, and because one part of the settlement was social housing, the other part was the only subsidized developer who was run by a woman at the time in Austria. And she said, let's invite, just talk to the people, let's invite them. And then they decided that I should present the project, and then I arrived there, and you hear these rather angry voices of people, because neighbors, before this was a gardening area, and people were looking at flowers, and so people were a bit upset about this urban development. I think it's the same everywhere. And I felt a bit shy to go there, because you just feel the anger. And then I started to explain, and when I said there will be 4 female architects doing the design, you really just feel the relief in the room. And someone said that it will, oh, okay, then it will not be too ugly. And in the Viennese kind of language, this is really a compliment, so that people were confident that it would be thoughtful to the neighborhood, and the developer agency said, because there was also this kind of public interest, that they really liked the project because the apartments rented much faster than the apartments in the neighborhood. This, you asked me if I know Elsa Prohaska. This was the design of the urban, the flat layout of Elsa Prohaska, which I think is really very, very innovative at that time. And it was really, we just wanted to show with this design that it's really adaptable for every phases of life and every family situation. And the rooms all have the same size, so you really can easily change the structure of the flat, but the furniture will always fit. It was also that she just wanted to show this outstanding of the kitchen, also to have this, just to show also the unpaid work. And as a reaction, and then as we started this already in the women's office. We were invited at that time. Vienna began to make a qualitative, because Vienna was at that period financing 80% of the new apartments were subsidized apartments. So the influence and impact was rather of the city was rather great, and so they decided to make a qualitative competition, and then they just decided to make developer competitions, and they invited me to be part of the jury. And so there really was about many years, as they have realized from this first project, that there was this sticking for quality and quality of everyday life. And so we have been invited by the politicians to be part of the game. And I think this is one of the most successful factors of mainstreaming, being part of the games, because housing subsidies, so yeah, this is really the decision about quite substantial financial means, and every community is a small community and is a village, And so they realized that there is really an influence and that this is taken seriously. And we developed some criteria. We made it very transparent. We made also a pre-qualification for single projects. And so over the years, I think there was really an improvement. For example, I call it, for example, secondary rooms as primary issue, because this is really something nobody talks about, pram stalls, but in everyday life, if you have a baby, it makes a difference how big, how near they are to the lift and things like that, or if there are rooms of anxiety and space of anxiety in the parking lots. And so we improved that, and also the semi-public space is very important, and specifically in different life situations. And so there was really a considerable improvement on the impact also on that aspect. Another topic is gender-sensitive park design. I think this was really, ideal, typical process of gender mainstreaming, because it started with a social scientific survey. Two very known feminist sociologists at that time, Edith Schlaffer and Cheryl Pinard, came to us and said they have worked in Germany and they got to know that there are specific playgrounds designed for girls. So I heard that for the first time, and want to do now a research about that in Vienna, and we financed it from the women's office, but it was in 36 public parks. And the outcome was very impressive, because they really could show that up to the time of 9 years, the number of boys and girls is quite the same in the parks, and on the playgrounds for the small children, the parents are there for justice and said, you have to wait, and now this one comes and so, but then the girls disappear and the number is reduced. And it's when I remembered when I was trained at the university, so about the needs of youngsters and kids, it was really only the male sport interests. So the picture of the youth in the public space were always male kids, and also the design for that. And they described it quite impressively, because of this lack of open space and this restricted space. We call it ball cages. We had to use high fences because everyone is very fond of playing football. And so they really described it as the law of jungle. So when the small boys are playing there and the older one come, then they small boys have to leave, and both, but the elder and the younger are really, that girls, it's not a place for girls there. And girls said in the interviews, but we also like to play football. And so we realized that we really have a problem there. And then we decided to make, we realized, then there were, so this research really created, showed that we have a problem and we have to do something. And it created also political awareness about that. And there was a strategy, we had a city strategy plan, and then the politicians, they said there should be a gender-sensitive playground in every district of Vienna, so their political goal was formulated. And then we, and at that time there was this change to the coordination office you have already mentioned, then we realized six model projects, six parks, also starting again with a small invited competition for two parks. And we also made four with active participation of girls, trying and testing different methods. And so out of that, and in the beginning, it was really political support, and the gardening department, there was a lot of resistance against it. It was a male planner running the planning office, and he really hated the idea. And then, but he had to do it because it was the political will. And then we had a big debate because we said the planners really should also have the ideas. They should also be sensitive, gender sensitive about it. Different peoples and boys and girls have different needs. And so this is also a qualification. And then we had a big debate about that. And then we realized there was really resistance. And so we have been part of the technical direction. It was also a bit a struggle of hierarchy. So the department and the technical direction and who is stronger. And then we said we have to go back, and then we have to explain. And at that time we were also rather self-convinced and also a bit, we know how it works and you are the stupid guy. And then we decided to go back and organized workshops and how these projects function. So this reporting from everyday life, getting reports. And then he came in a coffee break, and then he showed me, because one idea was to change the pattern, to open these ball cages, for example, because girls, they are less self-assertive in the average. And they attend, and then they just are coming in slowly and slightly. And so benches help, for example, to appropriate the space. And so there was also the redesign of these ball cages to make it more open, or to create a situation that different small groups can use it at the same time. And then he came and showed me and said, but we have done this also, a 10-year-old project. And then we realized, and we paid an evaluation of positive examples, and then said, please propose your projects, and we will organize an evaluation by university. And when with these positive examples and giving positive feedback, then he really took the idea, and until his retirement he became a big supporter. And then we said also in the debate, who will decide about who will be the planner? We said we create a pool, and if we don't have the same opinion, you are the one who will decide. And from this agreement on, we decided we never had a conflict again. So it was really, I think it really worked, because he really was convinced about the value, the practical value of the design. And out of that evaluation, we really made planning recommendations about gender-sensitive park design and playgrounds. And now every design or redesign of public parks now also follows these recommendations. So this was real mainstreaming. But I think it's also because public space is owned by the city itself. So there you have to convince people, but then you really have the power of definition. So it worked quite well. Here you see some pictures out of it, and one is also quite interesting, because here in the middle, these are all public parks, but in the middle, this is a hidden garden. It's for girls only. It's a music center, and they didn't have use of the gardens. And then there was feminist landscape planners, and they are given subsidies by the women's office. So it's a garden only for girls, and they said it's really quite interesting how the social roles really widens there, and they constructed the shed there, and then so it's really so this specific places also have its value in itself. And then we had in a new development area, this was also a competition again, an international competition, and we then had also with this new public management, so the politicians made contracts with the departments, the technical departments, and they were obliged, because gender mainstreaming is a top-down strategy, a political strategy, they were obliged to realize some pilot projects out of their annual working program in cooperation with our coordination office. And so this was also a pilot project about gender mainstreaming. And it's a 3-hectare park, and it worked out quite well. It was a Swiss office, Hager landscape architect, who won the competition. And it was also in this, so for example, that, and we also had this preparation of the tender where we have been involved, and realizing that there are a lot of institutions for elderly people, so there should be also a traditional flower garden there, so that there are specific areas for the different groups, and it really worked out quite well. Another topic is transport. We had one, this was also the idea of really doing not only single projects, but to have a whole process. And the traffic is quite a big topic. And so there was the idea of a gender mainstreaming pilot district. And it was a small, rather central district. And it was chosen because it's, I think, as far as I know, because also the districts have their own political board, it's the only district who has a women's commission. They had a new head of the political board, and she was a very strong woman who already put the focus on public space as her political, one of her political content. And so it was really that we, because before we have been in, have been part for the new mobility traffic concept for Vienna, I have been involved and was responsible for the working group for pedestrians and bikers. And then this was really the, how it will work, and it was that the participants, there were the 7 departments involved who were responsible, have to deal with public space, and they had the chance, or not the chance, they were lucky or unlucky that they just had to participate because they were responsible for the 6th district. And we made workshops there in the beginning, and there were different, quite a lot of small measurements, but with what it's every single photo here is quite a long debate behind. For example, there was the goal that 2 meters of sidewalks, which doesn't sound much, but in an old historical town, there's really the fighting for every centimeter because between the different traffic modes. And so this was written, it was standing in all the old mobility concepts, but it was something, it was just a nice formulated goal. And in the praxis, when there is a conflict of targets, nobody cared about pedestrians. And it was always that the lanes for cars, that is a rule which is unchangeable. And for pedestrians, it's just the space which rests. And so we really said, but in a metropolitan city, there must be possible that you can walk with your child and a pram, and that the 2 grown-ups can cross. And so there were really also broadened the some sidewalks. It's quite a hilly district, so this was this to create barrier freeness. About the safe crossing here, this was also a big debate because the head of the technical unit about street security, he said that won't work because it was a situation where there's a bus stop, and when the bus was standing there, the cars were going beside, and it was dangerous for pedestrians. And he said, that can't work. And she said, but I'm a politician, I want you to do that. And then she said, then let's try. And they tried it for 5-6 weeks, and now it's built and it functions, and it worked. Also the idea about traffic lights, so there was really also very simple measurements, for example, that elderly people very often are, if you have crossings and people start to walk, and then the cars coming around the corner, they really feel uncertain and go back and don't, and so it was a very simple measurement just to give them 3 seconds in advance of green light, and so they are just in the middle of the streets when the cars are coming. So there are small measurements, but with a lot of effect, also safety issues. So they really made this mobility commission and the women's commission, they made night walks and identified spaces of feeling of uncertainty in, and to really improve. They made a fixed budget of their small budget just to improve the lighting and to raise the feeling of subjective security there. And also these good conditions, so it's really this, for example, the technical department for road construction makes an inspection. Every 6 weeks they're marching, obliged to march around in the district for the technical, if there are problems, but they always were focused on the lanes and never looked at the sidewalks. And for wheelchair drivers, a small, was this Loch? Bitte? A small hole is a much more obstacle than a big hole for car drivers. So it's really also sometimes really this changing of awareness and what is defined as a problem from a technical part of view and what not. And also this debate about sidewalk cafes and this commercialization of public space and this fighting that the 2 meters are really a law. And so in the end, it was quite that these small measurements created really a network of improvement of quality. So this was realized over the years. And then there were elections, and I was really rather nervous because in the newspapers, if you're making measurements and in this conflict of targets, if you're making the focus on pedestrian issues, then sometimes you have to reduce the quality for car drivers, especially for parking lots. And I said, if this would not be a success and if they are punished on the political level, then you can forget about pedestrian needs for the next 10 years. And in the end, it was the district with the highest, run by Social Democrats, who had the highest wins of all the other districts. And so this was really also encouraging that people really realized this improvement of quality. What we have developed now over the years is some kind of fairness check. And it was also the branding. So this was also created in this pilot, during this pilot process, because we realized that gender mainstreaming is not a self-explaining expression. I realized it myself. If you start to use the word gender mainstreaming, then you took a deep breath, and then you need at least 5 sentences to explain it about the difference over biological sex and social roles, and. And then we created this fair shared city, because this is self-explaining and worked quite well, and this was a kind of branding of our projects for the future. And this fairness check is really about, because I think we produce as a planning administration, and I think a lot of planning administration over the world is doing it, produce a lot of planning poetry, as I call it, because at the end you have very convincing targets, and everybody says, yes, of course. But if you break it then down to the concrete measurements, then the gender bias becomes visible. You can't read it in the targets because they're always convincing. But in the concrete measurements, then you see what is really important. And if you are getting older, you get a bit tired of all this planning lyrics and beautiful goals. And then you start to look for the budget and for the square meters, and then you get the real estimation of different topics. And so we made, because at the end of this concept, you have a list of concrete measurements, and then we really made a, a board with different integration experts, gender experts, integration diversity experts, and then we defined different target group which depends from the topic, which are important groups, and then we really discuss the concepts and say, do the measurements work for them? What is the impact for them? Is there measurements missing for certain groups? And this really helps. It's a kind of quality assessment, and I think this is quite important. And we have done this for the concept of mobility and also for the concept of public space. Safety was an important issue, so we also, because the lighting department, they had very advanced technical criteria how they have to calculate the volume and lighting standards. And there is this writing that in spaces of anxiety or in uncertain spaces, the lighting level should be improved. And this technical standard is quite clear, how many, I don't know the measurement of light. But then it was, how do you identify the spaces of anxiety? And this was for technicians, it was really quite, they said criminal statistics, and we said, no, subjective safety is not. The unsafest place for women is their own apartment, which statistics prove. So it's, but nevertheless, it's a reduction of mobility if they feel uncertain. So lightning also helps. It's a mobility issue also. And then we made very different criteria, and the end was, if you have a 12-year-old son or daughter, would you let them go there or not? And then they should decide if they improve the lightning level. So these recommendations exist. But I think it's also not only on, so it's sometimes also important the symbolic level. And what you see before was this, you have designs in public transport, this specific seats you should offer to people. And this was just the idea, a graphic campaign about to show what this gender mainstreaming mean. And it was this change of role, and it was the design. And then we said, oh, that's so convincing, and now we have done this, and it's now in all the buses and metros here in Vienna. And city administration was very satisfied, because there were TV reports all over the world, so it was gratis advertisement for the city of Vienna, and they really liked the effect. So I think there was really an improvement, so this was really widening the topics of mobility issues. To be very shortly now, what we also have done is the social space analysis, that we really just, before designing or redesigning, specifically redesigning public space, really to look who are the users. And this watching people, asking people, again looking for different groups. So this was a migrant district with poorer population. And they said, we use it as our living room and don't make it too chic. So it was really quite interesting, because as planners we said, you have a problem. This is a 70-year design and we should improve it. And they had quite another perception of it. And youngsters were not there. They were using other spaces, because there was too much social control. And then we described all this. And then the outcome was, from 22 contributions, 21 designed a modern design for young people. And so it's really this social blindness and this really neglecting. So this was really interesting. But then I was there as a gender expert in the jury, and then we had long debates, because there was a aesthetical, more better project, but which was not social sensitive and didn't answer the social analysis. And then we decided for the more social intelligent project in the end, with all the votes for the for the social project. And this was won by German architects, landscape architects. What you also see is now, I think this is everywhere, this revelation of public space now, so this urban gardening, and I think there are a lot of really this from civil society and citizens, this appropriation of land. There are, I think, a lot of active women involved. But very shortly is Lake City Aspen. I think it's the biggest development area. So this was also part of it, a gender pilot project. But for example, what you mentioned, it was this day trips, so, or that we just changed the block structure because we have integrated kindergartens and that there is enough open space for the kindergartens and the inhabitants, and so the block structure must be an adequate one, which was not in the thinking before. Here again, you see the outcome of the lightning project. So there is really different lightning also for the pedestrians. And so this was really coming together, this gender-sensitive park design, the gender aspects also in the developer competition. So in these development areas, you see how it could work as a system. Also a shopping mall in the street. I think shopping and daily supply is very important, and this was really trying to make a shopping center in the street so that when people move there, they really already have all the facilities, but not an artificial shopping mall. And all the street names are female there. So you have the Janis Joplin Allee, or there are a lot of also a resistance of anti-fascist women involved in anti-fascist movement. Also in urban design, in other competitions, we made this pre-qualification, what I told you about kindergartens and block structures or the shading effects. Participation, so this is just a shot from a very normal, they just give it for my presentation. When you invite people, then it can come out like that, or it can be like that. And so you really have to be sensitive who is involved and who has the chance in this participation process. And our latest activities are now about we have now again started pilot projects, and with a specific focus also that we are looking for how this participation process can work, so that we really try also to see what asking people also for their age and their sex, and see if there are, so that we really can identify also the wishes with coming from which groups. So this is work in progress. And this is also redesign of a place. So that's, and also a new development area where I really can see this. I was involved there in this poetry of the master plan. And then if you then really see with all the decision makers and then really fighting about the budget for the park, for the Central Park, and then you really have to stick on it. And I think looking back, so the strategy really was that analysis and research create awareness, that pilot projects create visibility, that these lead projects also created practical experience, which I think is very important, and that with a lot of manuals and planning recommendations we created, we wanted to share the knowledge. We have been inspired by a lot of projects from Germany or Switzerland, so also to share our experience and our and also this dissemination. And I think with this mainstreaming, this is really hard work. It's not at all that it's running for itself. So this showing, we also have small film, and we have all produced our methods in a manual. So this is also, you find it in the internet, on all the different scales of planning. So what we have developed over the years. And I think the challenge is in a growing city there. I think we are on the beginning. What about this smart city? What does it mean? I think we're really in this period of restructuring digital city, climate change. So I think there are a lot of new topics we should go for, which will have a big influence. So this engendering of the new topics, I think this is really necessary. And I just would like to make a very personal resume. So, I think there was in the beginning, so I tried to tell you the beginning of it. And I think there was really a lot of resistance in the beginning. So when we started the exhibition, so where this was the poster, so it was really that at that time the colleagues, they had to make comments. This was quite usual. Normally you have then, it was in the different small departments of the planning department, and you just write comments that I have data, so please involve me, and they were very short comments. For this, there were two or three written pages full. And one was, if this exhibition is coming, I will ask for the exhibition, The Dog in the City. Or it was, what does it mean? A politician, the women's city councilor said that we have to pay the sidewalks in rose pink. Although this is maybe quite a nice idea. So there was a lot really of to make it ridiculous. And I think this has changed. Nobody would dare to say this again. But I think, again, it's really, we in German, we have the saying, it's like it becomes this soft resistance to these topics. So it's in auf Wattebeißen, so that I can't translate. So everybody says yes, but then you just ignore it. And it's also, for example, what Elsa Prohaska said, the architects, if you as a female architect, it's hard enough to be accepted and to be part of the play. But as a female architect or a female urban designer to stick for gender issues, then you really have the danger to become a bit invisible. So she, she said there was in Domus, in the Italian, there was really about, because it's a beautiful design she has created in Frauenwerkstatt, and there was the acknowledgement of Domus, but when she invited the doyen of the Austrian architecture criticism, he said, do I have to wear a headscarf if I'm going there? So he was just joking about it, and it was really just seen as a social project and not in its aesthetical outcome. So I think, and what I think is the most, disappointing is if females are making this play, and there are quite a lot of successful women who said, I don't want to... to be weakened by these soft social issues. So I think this is really a bit of a dialectical situation. But at the end, I think it also was really, for me, it was quite challenging, but it was also very satisfying over the years. As I told you, if you have this reaction from the everyday users, and if you get the response that it works and that it makes an improvement of quality, this strengthens, and then you have also this international network and this learning from each other. And as you mentioned, and also maybe this changing gender roles, for example, for this new participation projects, there were really young migrant fathers coming with their children and asking and said, we need better sitting facilities and I need a table in the playground. So I think there is really also hope and also these new civil citizen movements. So I think there is a lot of engaged people. And I think, as you have mentioned, Jeanne d'Arc, she was really burning for her ideas, but she was burning for her she, in the end, it was not so a lucky story for her because she was burned. And I say the Jeanne d'Arcs of today and tomorrow, they should burn. I think they burn for their ideas, and I hope they find also personal satisfaction, and we have the chance tomorrow to hear a lot and see a lot of their work. And I think we can, in 10 years, maybe there will be the symposium, Die Städte sind weiblich und von den Siegerinnen geprägt.